Students, now we are going to study next point of your chapter number 2, which is Clausius-Clapeyron latent heat equations. So Clausius-Clapeyron latent heat equations are important for finding out effect of melting point and boiling point of a substance with respect to pressure. So, if pressure of a substance changes, then how melting point and boiling point of that substance are going to change? That we are going to study in this point. So, for this latent heat equation, we have two latent heat equations. First one is first Clausius-Clapeyron latent heat equation and second Clausius-Clapeyron latent heat equation. So, first of all, we are going to study first latent heat equation. So, first equation. So, this is applicable for substance undergoing change which is first order. Okay. So, first order change means solid substance is converted into liquid state. So, we oftenly known that temperature as melting point, and second one is liquid into vapor state. Okay. So, we know that as boiling point. So, for a substance which is going change in first order, this equation is applied. And consider deriving first latent heat equation, we have considering 1 mole of a substance, okay, undergoing pressure and volume in thermodynamic state at constant temperatures, okay. So, that temperature is below critical temperature of a substance. So, in first chapter, you studied what is mean by critical temperature. So, if any substance is below critical temperature, then we know that the gas law equation is not applied. So, we have to apply van der Waals equation of state for that gas. And above critical temperature, Boyle's law and all gas law is applied. So, if that gas or substance is above critical temperature, then we know that at that temperature or for that substance is known as ideal gas. If that gas is there, then we refer that as ideal gas, and if that ideal gas is below critical temperature, then such gas is known as real gas. So, critical temperature is the rough boundary which decide either gas behave ideally or real. Okay. For that, we have to consider two isothermals. So, consider two isothermals at temperature T and T plus dT as shown in figure. So, I am drawing here pressure volume diagram, and suppose this is first isothermal of that substance. So, this isothermal at temperature T. Okay. Now, this isothermal is characterized by A, B, C, D. So, you already know if gas is undergoing this situation below critical temperature, so along CD it obeys gas law. Okay. So, this substance is in gaseous state and ideal state, and along BA it is in liquid state. So, this represent liquid state, this represent gaseous state, and this is the change of state. Means if you are going here to here, so that is liquid to gaseous state. Okay. So, along AB, that substance is in liquid state. Along BC, it is converted into gaseous state. And along CD, it is in, along after CD, it is in gaseous state. Now, we have considering second isothermal, which is at slightly higher temperature. Okay. So, I am drawing that over here, now for this isothermal is represented by G, H, I and J. So this is the isothermal. So again, along GH, that gas is in liquid state, along HI, liquid to gaseous state, and along IJ, this is in gaseous state. So we know that along this, the gas is started converted into liquid is started converted into gaseous state. So this is a boiling point temperature. Okay. So there the gas started liquefied. If you go reverse the sense, or if you go forward the sense, then we can say gas liquid is converted into gaseous state. Now we can connect these two isothermals by these lines, dotted lines. So call this as N and this as M. Okay. So if you take amount of substance along HI, N, then N, M, and from N, M to H. Okay. So if you take 1 mole of a substance along curve represented as HI, N, M, okay, H, I, N, M, and again H. So this is nothing but Carnot cycle. Okay, so how that is Carnot cycle? See, along H, I, this is isothermal expansion. Okay. So during HI, which is isothermal expansion, temperature is T plus dT. Okay. So here, this isothermal is plotted for a temperature T plus dT. And amount of heat energy absorbed is L plus dL. Okay. So we can say amount of heat energy absorbed is L plus dL. So L is latent heat of that substance. So amount of heat energy absorbed becomes L plus dL. Okay. So heat absorbed. Now along IN, there is adiabatic expansion. So during adiabatic process, there is no heat energy absorbed or rejected by that system. Okay. So along IN, there is no heat energy absorbed. So amount of heat energy again is L plus dL. Now along MNM, which is isothermal compression, along NM, here suppose volume here is V2 and here volume is V1. Okay. So here pressure is P and here pressure is P plus dP. So pressure remain constant along NM, almost constant. Okay. Or increases very slightly. But volume decreases from V2 to V1. Okay. So for very small change in pressure, there is very large change in volume. So along NM, suppose there is isothermal compression. Okay. Along this. And amount of heat energy rejected is L. So L is again latent heat. So we have amount of heat energy rejected by that is L and temperature is T. Now last curve is along MH, which is adiabatic compression. So during adiabatic compression, there is no heat energy absorbed or rejected. Now, from all this, for whole cycle, okay, so amount of heat energy absorbed dq by the system is, see, here we have amount of heat energy absorbed is L plus dL. Along this process, there is no amount of heat energy here rejected L, so that's why we have to give negative sign, and here there is no. So LL will cancel and we have dL. So dq is equal to dL is the first equation. Now, since this is Carnot cycle, and we know that for Carnot cycle, since this is a cyclic process, change in entropy is zero. So we have to find out change in entropy during the process. So we know that change in entropy dS is dq upon T, where dq is amount of heat energy absorbed. Now, along HI, amount of heat energy absorbed is L plus dL, okay? And T means temperature. So along HI, temperature is T plus dT, okay? Now, along IN, there is no heat energy absorbed. That's why change in entropy is zero. Along NM, heat is rejected, which is L. That's why we have to take minus sign. So minus L is the amount of heat energy rejected, and this is at temperature T. So this is change in entropy. Along MH, there is no heat energy absorbed or rejected. That's why change in entropy is zero. So this is net change in entropy, and this must be zero. So if you solve this equation, we have taken this on right hand side, okay? So L plus dL, we can take T over here, is equal to L into T plus dT. So L into T plus T dL is equal to L into T plus L into dT. So L into T will cancel, and we can write from this equation dL is equal to L into dt divided by t. This t goes on right hand side. So call this as equation 2. Okay. Now, from first law of thermodynamics, what is statement of first law of thermodynamics? Dq is equal to du plus dw. Now, for this cyclic process, Carnot cycle, which is HINM and H, since this is cyclic process, change in internal energy is zero, okay, in this equation. And dW, which is work done, is the area under curve, okay? Now, this cyclic process, area under curve is area under this, okay? Now, we have taken very infinitesimal change. That's why this is shape of rectangle, and area of rectangle is base multiplied by height. So, base is this V2 minus V1, this length is V2 minus V1, since here volume is V2, and here this distance is V2, this distance is V1, so this distance is V2 minus V1, which is base of this rectangle, and height of this rectangle, since here pressure is P, okay, and here pressure is P plus dP, so this distance is dP. So base is V2 minus V1 and height is dP. So dW is base V2 minus V1 multiplied by dP. So put that in equation 3. And dq means net amount of heat energy absorbed. So we know that net amount of heat energy absorbed from equation is dL. So we have to use all those in equation 1, we will get what we will get. DL is equal to now DU, which is 0, and DW is V2 minus V1 into DP. So call this as equation number 4. Now from equation 2 and 4, we can write instead of DL, okay, from equation 2, we can write L into dt divided by t is equal to v2 minus v1 into dp. If you take this term on right hand side, this term on left hand side, then dp divided by dt is equal to L divided by t into v2 minus v1. Okay, so this is the first latent heat equation. Now if you take heat energy in joules, then you have to multiply this equation by J. So J is mechanical equivalent of heat. Okay. So L into J divided by T into V2 minus V1. Now we are going to study effect of melting point and boiling point on pressure. So first of all, effect on of pressure on boiling point for substance. Now see, boiling point is the temperature when liquid is converted into gas. So you already know volume of gas is more compared to volume of a liquid. Why? Because molecules get apart from each other. Okay, so distance between molecules in case of liquid is higher compared to gaseous. So V2 is greater than V1, so V2 minus V1 is a positive quantity in this equation. So if this is positive quantity, then dp divided by dt is again positive quantity, then we can say boiling point is directly proportional to pressure. So means as pressure increases, boiling point also increases. As pressure decreases, boiling point decreases. Okay. So that is the principle you can see in pressure cooker. In cooker, all the water is enclosed and water vapors are at higher pressure relative to other atmospheric pressure. That's why boiling point of water in pressure cooker is more. Okay, so that's why water does not boil or get converted into vapor easily. That's why we can get food very easily compared to open case. Now, effect on melting point. Now, here two cases arises. First case is similar to this. If substance is expanding under melting, if substance melt and its volume increases, so in that case we have similar case, melting point is directly proportional to pressure. And second case where this term is negative means what? There are substances which contracts on melting, for example ice. Ice contracts on melting, so volume of ice is more compared to liquid. So in that case, melting point is reciprocal of pressure. Means what? As pressure increases, melting point decreases. Okay, and vice versa. Means melting point is reciprocal of pressure. So in this way, we can use Clausius-Clapeyron first latent heat equation to find out effect on melting point and boiling point. So boiling point is directly proportional to pressure of the substance, and for melting point two cases arises. Okay, so with this we finish our this point, which is Clausius-Clapeyron first latent heat equation.